One final set of functions that dplyr provides is set-like operations, right? When we did anti-join, semi-join, etc., we were actually performing set kind of operations. There are explicit set operations also provided in dplyr, right? So for example, suppose we have these two tuples with values x, y, right? 1, 1, 2, 1, 1, 1, 1, 2, right? So df1 is triple x, y, 1, 1, 1, 2, 1. That is this one. And df2 is this one. Okay? So now df1 is this, df2 is this. We could do intersect df1, df2. That is, show me which rows are common to both of these tuples. Okay, that is set intersection, right? A intersection B is what is common to both A and B. Similarly, when you say intersect df1, df2, you've got two tuples and you're trying to find out which rows are common to both of those tuples. This is very useful, especially when you're doing data tidying and so on. You might find this to be really useful. Now, this is different from, regular joins, right? Because in joins, you're looking for matches, not of the entire row. You're looking for matches across specific columns. But here you're saying, show me from the two tuples which rows are exactly common to both of them. Okay? Of course, there is also the set operation union df1, df2, which basically is going to produce all the rows. Okay, so it's going to take all the rows, but it's going to not show the duplicates, right? So 1, 1 is duplicated, but it occurs only once here. Okay, it doesn't occur twice. Okay, so that is what union is. Show me all the elements in both of the tuples, but don't duplicate any of the rows. Okay. Set difference is df1, df2, which is show me basically df1 minus df2. Show me df1, take out all the rows which are common between df1 and df2. Okay, that is df1 minus df2. Whatever is common to df1 and df2 is taken away, so therefore only 2, 1 remains. Okay, so if you do set diff df1, df2, you get this. If you do set diff df2, df1, of course, you now get 1, 2, because 1, 1 is also common to both of those. Okay, so these are some set operations which are sometimes very useful, right? So in this sense, you know, we've looked at lots of different functions that dplyr provides. It's a very rich package for manipulating data, and I would say it's a very rich and very comprehensive, complete package. So when we are talking about exploratory data analysis with R, we are going to be doing a lot of work in dplyr and of course ggplot, right? Now, all of the examples we saw with ggplots, many of the examples had to do with small data sets where we could show the entire data set, especially when you're doing scatter plots, you could show the entire data set in the form of scatter plots, right? Now, typically, when you're working with very large data sets, you won't be doing that. You won't be plotting the entire data set. Instead, what you will typically be doing is summarizing the data in many different ways and plotting the summarized result. Okay? So between the two of them, ggplot and dplyr provide an extremely versatile and powerful set of packages for doing all kinds of exploratory analysis, right? So at this point, really, what is critical is our imagination. If we are able to imagine what we want, within a matter of minutes, we can do the processing. Okay, so we don't have to think about, you know, how is my tool going to help me to do this? That is very easy. We are given with very powerful packages. But the more important thing is asking the right questions, right? So to say, okay, here's a data set. What are the things I would like to ask of this data set, right? So the onus is on us to ask the right questions. Once we frame the right questions, it's a breeze to use dplyr and ggplot to really bring to life whatever it is that we are thinking of.